Yeah, okay. I guess it's time to continue with the program. Good, so let's start with the second part of the day. The next talker will be Carsten Hofmeier. It's me, I will be talking about an overview and provide an introduction to new semantic extensions which have been created during the past year. Just to give you an idea, there's something new out in the field, and it may be used if it appears useful to you. So, let's start. So, that's me, Carsten Hofmeier, and I do the overview and introduction to new semantic extensions. And that's the table of contents. So I will be talking about five extensions which have been created during the past year. And actually, only three of them really have a hard dependency on Semantic Media Wiki. For the two extensions you see in the bottom, you can actually run them without having a Semantic Media Wiki installed. But it will help to use it if you have Semantic Media Wiki too. So let's start. The first one, it's quite a name, a getüm. It's called Semantic External Query Lookup. And here we are. It's this extension. It was created, hasn't been released yet, but it's, let's say, in beta status for over half a year now, and it's actually working, so it's quite a stable extension. It was created by James Hong Kong, and it will be requiring, most probably in alpha it works with Semantic Media Wiki 2.4, but there are still some changes will be done, which most probably will require then 2.5 as a version to be installed as a minimum requirement. And actually what it does is it allows querying data from external wikis. So, and it uses the API, and this API is just needed to access the remote wiki, and there are some things which can't be done at the moment. Read API denied wikis can't be accessed right now, and if you query for files, you only get the link to the file, not the file displaying itself. But actually what it does is you have wiki A and you have a remote wiki B, and you can do a semantic query on semantic data on wiki B, which is a remote wiki. So that's quite a nice feature. It's easy. So for example, you have on one remote wiki, you have a annotation called a page called Semantic MediaWiki Control 2016. You set some values to it, start and finish, and then on the local wiki, so that it can work. That's a configuration example. So you provide for this, you configure per each remote wiki. You have you assign a key, and you assign a corresponding name to the query processor used for this wiki, and this will be required. And if you're using interwiki data, which is stored in your interwiki table, you wouldn't have to create it. But if you're using a wiki which wasn't set up in the interwiki table yet, then you have the optional possibility to add the data in your configuration file. So you mustn't necessarily go to the database and add this interwiki data or install the interwiki extension. You just do it like this. And you add the interwiki URL, interwiki API, and you say, okay, will it be a local wiki or not for the local wiki. And then on the local wiki, you do just a query. Yeah, in this, so you ask, and then I don't select the page. I say, okay, I ask for this SMB Conf 2016 page, and I want to know about the planned start and planned finish. And good, you see this new formatting you have, yeah. And then you label it start and end date. Then you add the source, so you get the source parameter. That's the key, wiki key you defined in your configuration. And then the rest is just pure ask queries, nothing different. And the result is my first external query. You see, okay, that's on the local wiki. It's fetching the data from the remote second wiki, and you get a little table showing you the data and details which were requested. So that's a quite a nice thing. And this repository is at that position, and then the location of the documentation, and there's even a little video. The second extension, yes. Yes. Okay, so if there's a, yeah.
Is it possible to have combined local and remote queries? Like asking at the same time data from the internal
wiki? I wouldn't say no, because you specify a source in the ask query, so that's pointing to a specific wiki. So no, you can't. So if that would be a feature you would like to see, that might be a request. No. Yeah, no problem. So if there's another quick question about it? No, good. So and the next one, semantic notifications extension. This again was not yet released. This is a stable version. And also this was created by James. And it requires Semantic Media Wiki 2.4 and later. And what it does is it allows notifications about changes to structured data. And there are three kinds of changes which trigger a notification. The first one is there a category, and was the setup of a category somehow changed? The second one was if a page was added to a category, you get an info, and which is quite a nice thing, I guess. And the same thing, was the value added to a property? Let's say, was the value changed to a property? So that's actually wrong. You get a notification as soon as the value was changed in the property, which might include adding some value to a property. And yeah, and actually it uses the echo extension. So you can get notifications on the wiki itself. You know this from the wikis from run by the Wikimedia Foundation. You have this little bubble, which is first you have this red thingy, and then you can click on it and you get this bubble informing you about things that happened that might be of interest to you. And yeah, and the other thing is email notification. That's not yet working. There's some issue with Echo or presently this doesn't really play, but it's, yeah, will be nice if it's possible some time. And you have user preference settings, like for all the other notification incidents, or you can say, okay, inform me on the web via the interface or send me an email. So it's possible to, on a per user basis, to fine grain the notifications you get. And yeah, and it uses special properties to set up the notification system as such, saying at what instance do I want to get a notification, and who should get the notification, and actually you can also specify on which values a notification should be sent. So yeah, so two are needed to define the recipients. Yeah, you define these are special properties. So you define a user group. It mustn't be a user group defined in the configuration file. That's another thing. But you call it user group whatsoever, and then you add to the category page or the property page you want to provide information from which user groups should be notified. And yeah, and in the second step you can determine if the notification should be done on all property value changes or just if a specific value gets added or removed. And yeah, here you go. And yeah, that's this example setup. So you have a property page, project status. Yeah, that's what you would add. The first part is just the standard setup of a property. Yeah, you define the type and so on, the allows value. That's just standard semantic media wiki. That's not specific to semantic modifications, but you can have these values. And then in the bottom, you use these special properties I told you about before to set up the notification system. So here you have, you can say, okay, if the value changes to start, in progress, complete, and so on, then notifications are sent to users which are in these special two groups. And at the same time, you can set another system to this property and say, okay, over budget, then in budget, over budget is more interesting for these people, so they only get notifications if these values are somehow assigned or changed. And yeah, and so on the user page, you would add up, okay, this bloke is a member of the project member group, and then on the project page, SMBcon, you have this code, and then you add, you know, in progress as a status via the property I set up the notification system for, and then you get this little note on the top, and then you see this bubble or this information thingy showing up, and then you can say, okay, a value was modified for project status on that page, and then you can decide, do I want to see the change, or do I want to go to that project page and have a look what's now the current status of it, and yeah. And yeah, the repository is on this location in some documentation. There's more to it, but these are the most important things you can have a read through and have a look at. And yeah. The sad thing is at the moment that it doesn't work with sending emails, but at one point that should obviously be possible to make it really useful and round extension, I would say. And questions to this extension? Remco? Yes, I'm not sure if it does, but if it doesn't, that would be a good thing to have. Yes, so if it's not working right now, then it should be a feature request. Yes, indeed, that's a useful use case to it. No. Because let's say a concept is like a dynamic category, so it works on categories, so it might work or should be possible, or let's say, but, you know, conceptually speaking, if it works for categories, it should be able to get this running for concepts. Yeah. Good question. Yeah. And someone else? Okay, no. So the next extension I try to introduce, that's a semantic Scribunto extension. Also, this is not yet released, but it requires just Semantic Media Wiki 2.3 or later, and what it does, it provides native support of Semantic Media Wiki to the Scribunto extension. So people who are working a lot with Scribunto and with Semantic Media Wiki might like to, let's say, to mesh up functionality here. So this one is seeking to help here, and for me as a non-programmer, it's a bit esoteric, so I can't really get into too much detail here, but I think there are some people who might really be interested in having a look, and actually there are people already using it and providing patches for it, so it's somehow it has hit a missing feature. So it's used with the invoke parser function, which is done with Lua, and this thing uses the module namespace and provides two functions: the getQueryResult function. So you get in a serialized format returns from the API module, and it's like an action asked, and then the result, and this can be now, let's say, transformed into other things you might want to do on a wiki with a result representation in JSON format. And the other thing is it returns just strings, like for property type, just here, that's for date type, and not sure yet if that's the thing to use, but these are the functions which are currently available. So have a look at it if it's something you might want to use or work with on your wiki. I'm not really, okay, you know the story. And the repository that's also in the Semantic Media Wiki main repository, and that's the Semantic Ubuntu extension. There's documentation to it, obviously. I think no film, or I didn't find it. And but that shouldn't be a hold up for power users. So so I see there are no questions. And the next extension, that's the summary cards extension. And that's an extension which is also not really, and this one doesn't have a, but these are all already for half a year on the Sandbox wiki, and it didn't cause any crashes or things like that, and it's actually working from the examples which were added there. So it's, yeah, it's, I wouldn't say that it's a major risk to have a look at it, no. And it reminds me a bit of the Hovercard extension, which the MediaWiki Foundation is using for displaying pictures if you hover over a link within an article and so on. And this one shows you the related, let's say, photograph or picture or image for that article. And this one actually does the same, but it allows you to provide also some content information. So so you can use Semantic Media Wiki, for example, to fetch information from property values which were assigned to a page, which you you see when you hover over, and you know, you don't have to press it, you get a little card and you can see, and that's things like these. It uses user-defined templates. So you can actually define what information is shown in the card, in the summary card. So if you see, okay, it's done on a per namespace basis. So that's a bit of configuration you need in the back end. Then you can say, okay, I have a main namespace. All the summary cards should have this format and fetch this and that information. And on the user namespace, for example, obviously I have different information there, so I would set up a different template for this extension to use on the user namespace, and so on and so forth. And it provides parameters which fill in missing data on the query. So like a subject and so on. The subject would be the page name, shows up on the summary card, or as in category, then it would show the categories, so you don't really have to do it. It relieves a bit from doing some wiki text voodoo, which you would probably have to do if these weren't there. There's a couple of them there, and it also integrates with the in parser function. This is the one, I don't know, we talked about this on the tutorial day. There was one question about using the internationalization of this in parser function. This one helps selecting on a user preference basis or showing messages in different languages if they are there on the wiki. And you can cache information So if the page hasn't been touched for a long time and so on, then the information would come from the cache, and then it's reducing a bit the load you're getting. And yeah, and of course, as a user, if you say, I don't want to see summary cards, when you just switched off in your user preferences, and here you go. It's just a matter of taste. And yeah, that's, for example, a template you can use to create a summary card. I strip the HTML and CSS things. Yeah, you still have to imagine that you have to wrap some P tags and so on to have a little formatting there, or a little table if you would like to. And these are, yeah, that's usual parser functions. When you know is file, you see if there's a file. If that's true, then you do this and that. And you have these parameters, and then you have a description. You have a subject. You can say, okay, this page is in user language, whatsoever, namespace, and things like that. You can add all of this, and yeah, that's how the result would look like here on a search page. You would get a summary card, you know, the subject would be page name, and then gives you a little excerpt of what's on there, the user language on this page, EN, English, and the same if you're on special browse, and if you hover over the link to Johann Sebastian Bach, then you would get the same summary card, so it works on, yeah. I think it also works on recent changes and so on, but only for pages where it makes sense. So you wouldn't get a summary card for a change to a media wiki namespace, for example, because that's, yeah, wouldn't be of much benefit. No? And yeah, that's where you find the repo for it, to have a peep at the code and to perhaps fetch the code and install it in your wiki and see if it's working or not, and if it's it's something you could consider using. And the documentation, it's in the code base as such too, in the doc, how you call it, folder, and here you go. So if there are questions for this? No. So I proceed to the last extension. I'm giving you a little idea of so this will be what's nearby extension that's probably best used in connection with geographical data. And also, same thing, it requires maps 3.5 to work, and this doesn't have a hard requirement on semantic media wiki, so it's not, can be used without it, and it provides, you know, geolocation from information which can be fetched from the browser and so on, and allows to push this into the templates you use for queries you do, and display information on spots whatsoever nearby your current location. And and you have variables, so you can slide through it and change the location and so on, and it adapts to it. And you can have distance queries. And you can see if you have a page on a little point of interest you want to see on this page, or display already what's next to this location when you would use this, what's in the vicinity of this location. And you can use this to also pass on information to an ask parser function to get lists to and stuff like that. And it works with a nearby parser function. And that's, I've already talked about. And you have parameters which are used with a nearby parser function to pass information on, so query template, so you have a nearby parser function, you have a query template, and then the display of information would be passed on to a query template, and on this template further information can be queried. Yeah. And it detects location detection is in there, And that would be an example query. You know, you have a nearby parser function, you have a query template. Actually, you can define several query templates. So if you want to have an overview of libraries, in local libraries from your position, actual position, or points of interest, and so you can add coordinates, radius, things. These are all these parameters which I talked about. Yeah, you have control if it's a slider or something like that, and that's how it's done. And now the next slide shows you an example for query template. So you have this on top, and this query template now pipes the stuff into these templates here, and then you can actually retrieve information, also parameterized, and that's just to give you an idea how this might look like. And in the end, actually, that's the result you would be getting. Yeah, so you get the map. If you have a slider, you can slide, let's say, what's within the vicinity of 1K or 2Ks and so on. And at the bottom, it also gives you a list of the spots it found. No? And that might be quite an enhancement for wikis too. No, I think in Vienna we saw we were introduced to the Graz wiki. Perhaps they would like to use it because we have all this data tech and all this history of buildings and so on, different types of buildings. So that would be one use case for WebWiki, for example. And I'm not talking too much about it because it can also be used without media, with semantic media wiki, and Meropo again with documentation. And So that's basically it.